much for joining us at True View Ministries. I'm Jamie Shaver, and this is Julie Van Gorp. We're so grateful that you've joined us. We also have some guests with us today, and we're very excited about that. Nancy, Gina, and Kate, all of them moms, all of them wives, and we're really honing in on these parenting issues today as we talk about how to, teaching our children how to discern between good and evil. Julie, why is it so important?
Well, Jamie, it's always been important for us to know the difference, and evil's existed since the garden. It just seems that that wickedness is increasing in these days, and as the word says, it'll wax worse and worse. And so it's harder sometimes, especially because Satan will come disguised as the angel of light, to discern what's good and what's evil. But just to give you an idea of how things have changed, and just in America again, we know that when our founding fathers started this country, it was absolutely, the Bible was the preeminent look to for all morality. And we have moved away from that to the point where just recently the Ten Commandments were removed from a school because a teenage student in the school objected to them being there. And they had been there since the 1990s. But, you know, stories like that are legion. There was a picture of Jesus that was removed from the halls of a school, and they had been donated in 1947. It had been there all those years, but then the atheists now are saying, oh wait, that's somehow influencing how I am living, you know, my days. And so we in so many ways seems to have lost our moral compass of what is right and what's wrong.
I know, so the question for me becomes, how do we teach our children to discern between good and evil when some of the basic foundational principles like the Ten Commandments are being removed? If that was the standard and that was has been the foundation, as those things are being ripped out of our society as a whole, you know, how do we go about doing that? I know for me personally, I've really begun asking my children to define for me, what path is this decision put you on? Because we're all on a path, and the Bible tells us that God makes our path straight. But when we deviate from his plan, or we're deviating into a realm of something that God would call evil, that's going to put you on a different path. Where does that path lead to? And really trying to teach them to gain that mindset that says, where am I going? Where does this one decision, where is that going to lead to?
You know, and Jamie, I think one of the things as you even share that really triggers with me is wide is the path that leads to destruction and narrow is the gate, and, you know, few find it. And so what we want to do with our children is make sure that they're on not the broad path, but that narrow path. And in a culture where they're calling good evil and evil good, it's going to be harder. And a lot of times we're going to be going like that salmon kind of upstream, you know, from where everybody else. Is that something that you all wrestle with? Is it where you see either friends or neighbors or family members who seem to say, oh, everything goes, kids will be kids, it's all right, and yet you're trying to rein in and say, but wait a minute, I don't want my children to be exposed. Is that something you wrestle with at all?
Absolutely. I mean, I think just everything in general, all around, we have television shows that don't show a good example. They have a rating of Y7, but a 7-year-old should not be watching half of these shows.
Probably a 70-year-old.
Exactly. It's inappropriate. The comments are definitely crossing the line where a child should have so much more of an innocence about certain things, and it does cross the line on that, and it's just very hard in a worldly world to keep those things away from your children and to just teach them about the pureness and the beauty of following the Lord.
Is that something you wrestle with too, Nancy?
I totally agree. And we've set in place a lot of things in our home to try to avoid that. We don't have mainstream television, cable coming in. And as a decision, as a family, we just don't want that type of influence on our children. We decide what shows that they watch. And, you know, it's through a Christian network that we're able to get programming. And we still screen that because, you know, we want to be in control of what they're watching.
And where your standards might even be different from what the mainstream Christian find acceptable. Right. But I bet a few people may look at you, Nancy, and think, what has she got? You know, horns growing on her head. That's crazy. Aren't you denying your children? And how are they going to learn to operate in the world if they don't have that? I'm sure that that's one of the responses you might get, even if they don't say it to you, that they, you know, people might be thinking. So.
It is. And we have a 21-year-old, a 19-year-old also, and with them I've had to have a little bit different guidelines without so much, I don't have as much control when they go to the movies of what they see. Mm-hmm. So I've encouraged them all along, you know, read a review of it, and I particularly like the Plugged In Review website because
I focus on the family,
them.
Isn't that? Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And that's PluggedIn.com.
Right. And I make them read it and come back and tell me, especially as they're getting up towards that age, I made them come back and tell me what they experienced when they saw it and if they agreed with the review and to see what they learned from it. Because I think that's what's important.
Right.
Is how, what really was it about and did it hurt? Was it with what God would tell us that would be good or was it not?
Mm-hmm. And it seems like in that too, Nancy, where you've laid a foundation for them to know what truth is, so then they're in a position to discern whether or not that would be righteous or whether it would be evil or good or bad, however you want to describe that. And so you've already instructed them in that path. So.
And that goes along with what Proverbs 1 says. You know, Proverbs 1, verse 1 through 5 is the beginning of knowledge, and these are Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, which the Bible tells us was the wisest man who has ever, you know, been a human, born of man. And it says, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, judgment, and equity, to give prudence to the simple, to the young man, knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase learning, and a man of understanding will attain wise counsel. And that's really that, what it sounds like you've done such a good job of doing that. So how would you say that you've gone about instilling that? And Kate, I'd like to hear from you on that as well.
I think just by, as we make the decisions, just continually reinforcing it. You know, what are you seeing? You know, is it glorifying to God? Just kind of making it part of our daily walk is into what we do.
So that's really your basic question, Nancy, in your household is, ultimately, does this bring glory to God?
Right.
What about you, Kate?
Yeah, I'd have to agree. Lining everything up with Scripture, is this going to please God? And teaching your kids that, because ultimately they are, like Nancy said, going to make their own decisions on what movies and what they read, what they do. So I think constantly kind of teaching, this is not my standard, this is God's standard, and so we're trying to honor that. For me, homeschooling has been nice because we have a community of people around us that believe a lot of the same things. The one issue that has come up is dating. Our 14-year-old is not going to date. He doesn't want a date. He's bought into it. We've talked a lot about it. But it's adults, not kids. It's adults that look at me like, what do you mean he's not going to date? Where is he going to get experience? And that's kind of the battle we're coming up against, standing firm on no, we're not dating, and this is why.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, Kate, you're bringing that up. I think a lot of times people would say, okay, what's dating have to do with good or evil?
Yeah.
But I think that, to me, goes back to, if we're going to discern what's good and evil, we have to discern what are the strategies of the enemy or the tactics. And the Bible tells us, do not be ignorant of the enemy's schemes. Mm-hmm. And instead, we're to expose them. And that seems to me like you're wise enough to know a 14-year-old may not be able to handle the adult consequences that can come about when you're in a dating relationship.
Well, tell me, like, what do you say to your child when you say he's really bought into it? I mean, what idea or what have you shared with him?
It goes back to the good and evil and pointing to Scripture. And so from the very beginning, we did the Passport to Purity program with him and talked about the reasons why dating isn't good for a 14-year-old and what could happen. And we've talked about how his relationship with God is the most important relationship he needs to work on right now. And when you're 14, your relationship is not strong enough with the Lord yet. You need to keep pursuing that. And if you were to date, you're going to pull a girl away from the Lord or a girl who doesn't know the Lord. And so it's just not the time. And he believes that. And he told me the other day, he goes, I want to wait till my wedding day to have my first kiss. Now, I pray that he holds to that. But, you know, it's just different in this day and age. It's definitely a very different standard to have.
Mm-hmm. But one worth pursuing. I can
it is.
Tell you, having having a son that was in that position where I guess he had, you know, had a kiss before, but his bride had never kissed anyone
That's
until
beautiful.
Their wedding date. And again, most people would go, are you you can't really
that is laughable. Come on. I've actually had Christian women tell me that even just to want a child to be pure, not even talking about having a first kiss, that I needed to get real.
Right.
And come to grips with reality. Mm-hmm.
But I'll that's not that realistic.
It's not realistic at all. And don't they need to know how all that works? And they need to know that they're compatible with this person. And I'm thinking, God made them to be compatible.
Look at all those years of arranged marriages, mm-hmm. you know, that worked out where they didn't know each other. And here we think. But I think that's, I applaud you on that, Kate. Because I think that's where getting a hold of the heart of the child mm-hmm. is really, again, what's important. Because you could invoke a lot of those, you know, standards, but you're going to raise a rebellious child who's always balking at it unless they know that you care about their welfare and God cares about their welfare and that their commands are for their good, not just to restrict them from ever having fun.
Now, so. Gina, as a new believer, because I know
yes.
you have recently...
I know, lots of things are going through my head right now listening to all of this.
I know she recently just really got involved in Bible study and mm-hmm. reading God's Word, which is just so exciting to watch you grow. Yes. How do you, when you're looking at things like Hunger Games or Harry Potter or some of the, what I would call more controversial type of entertainment, where do you go or what kinds of things do you do, would you say, to begin teaching that which you're still so new at learning yourself?
Well, I have to say we've never crossed the Harry Potter bridge. At my house, my children show no interest in it at all. My oldest loves dogs. And if it's not about dogs, she's not interested. So luckily...
Rejoice.
Yes, luckily that hasn't been an issue at all. And then my son is not really into any of that as well. So we haven't gotten into that. But there was an instance where your daughter was actually spending the night at my home with my daughter, and there was another girl there, and they were talking about ghosts. They were speaking about things that they shouldn't be speaking about, and it was in pure innocence. And, you know, 5 years ago, if somebody were to say, oh, my kids were talking about, you know, light as a feather, stiff as a board, I kind of would have looked at it and been like, okay, it doesn't do anything. It can't get you anywhere. But the more and more I dive into the Word and more I read, I realize the evil that is in that. That is not what God wants us to be doing. And it's situations like that where, you know, I'm so thankful that you called that to my attention to tell me about it. That was something where I could speak to my daughter and say, no, 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 no. We can't do this because this is inviting the enemy in. Mm-hmm. So it's just, you know, taking experiences like that and applying them. And like I said, I can't really apply Harry Potter or anything like that because we haven't gotten there. But, you know, just simple things. And as I read, as I speak to other Christian people and I hear things, you know, we do listen to the regular television. You know, we do have that on. But there are many times where we are turning the TV off because of what is on. Mm-hmm. There's many times where we're talking about what is on because they shouldn't be watching it.
And I have to just give you credit, Gina. And you know, I think this is such an admirable attribute to your character, is that you have always been so open to receive information from God's Word. Where Absolutely. Even if initially it went up against some hard and long-held beliefs that you had mm-hmm. had, you were never coming at it in anger or in a way that was very defensive. Instead, you've always been mindful of just keeping an open mind and just even remaining silent mm-hmm. and listening. And then I know, because you'd send me texts or emails, that then you're looking that stuff up yeah. on your own and saying, okay, this wasn't just her opinion. Mm-hmm. This is actually what God's Word says, and it's just been such a joy to kind of come alongside as your friend and say, wow, she's at least being open to these ideas and not just saying, that's ridiculous, or that's not reality. You know, those standards right. are too high in recognizing
well,
what His Word
What I find is really interesting is growing up in a non-Christian home, I was always taught no sex before marriage, respect your parents. This laundry list of things. I'm getting the chills thinking about it. Guess where we get that from? The Bible.
Exactly.
It's all in the Bible. Sorry. And it just excites me to have it reaffirmed over and over and over again. Good morals, staying away from evil, it's going with what the Bible says.
Absolutely.
Well, we can't know good if we don't know God.
Absolutely.
Right. You just can't. Mm-hmm. You can't separate the two. And so what about you, Kate? Have you guys... The Hunger Games, Harry Potter, where do you guys stand as a family on that? I know that this is an issue that can become controversial within Christian communities.
It very much can.
Kate, What are the ages of your children again?
They range from 14 to 3, 14, 12. I have 2 9-year-olds. One of my 9-year-olds is adopted, and I have a 3-year-old. And those are very good questions because it varies from parent to parent, I think, and child to child. For us, we have read Harry Potter, but see, I read them first. I read them all first and made sure they were okay. And then I read the first few books. I should say my older children have read Harry Potter. My fourth child, who's adopted, is not ready to read it. He's just not ready, so I've held him back from that.
What makes you say he's not ready? How do you know that as a parent?
He struggles. Well, for him, he struggles. I'm not so sure he's grounded in the word yet. I'm trying. I don't know if he gets it. And until he gets that, and we can talk about some of the issues in there, I'm not ready for him to read it.
So were you really using these almost as a guide to teaching your children mm-hmm. discernment?
Oh, yes.
To say this is truth and this
yes.
isn't, and how do we know?
Yes, and we talked about that. We read the books together initially, and we talked about them as we read them. We talked about some of the issues. And this is really funny, though. I find a lot of people, I think that, I'm not saying everyone should let their children read Harry Potter. Definitely not. This is a family-to-family thing. But I came across one professional who was speaking and telling everyone that they should not let their children read Harry Potter, and he was talking about how bad it was. So I had to go up after him at this convention, and I had to ask him, well, why? And he was telling me some things, and I said, well, did you read the books? He's like, well, no, I've never read them. And I felt like, what, you're not an expert. We can't talk about this until you read it. So that's the key, is reading it. Now, Hunger Games is a whole different story for me. I did, with my oldest son, when he was 13 last year, we started reading them together, and he was reading them as fast as I was. We read through the first one, I was okay. Second and third, I was not okay with. So we put a stop to it. First one we felt was okay. So I won't let my other children now read those. But so it's definitely a book I suggest.
Do you think that can go too far? Because I have heard some Christian women saying, I want to read 50 Shades of Grey, where when you read, all you need to do is take one glance at any report or review on that book, which I can tell you I've not mm-hmm. read the books. But I think there becomes that place where it can be used then as an excuse to say, well, I'm just learning maybe what the other side is.
Well, I would say read the books, because when I read Harry Potter, I did not see the evil that everybody else saw in it. I didn't feel convicted by God. I prayed about it. I didn't see that. I saw some magic in it, but I've seen magic in many other books that children are said to read. I saw a lot of parallels to the Bible in Harry Potter that you could pull that out and go, oh, that's really cool. Look how, you know. Now, Harry Potter is not Jesus, and we were very clear on that.
But, yeah.
So I think that there are lines you can cross that you cannot justify, that this book is okay because we're going to read it because it's so evil. We're going to try to teach them that it's evil. Well, we don't have to indulge in evil to know it's evil. I did not feel like that book crossed the line, whereas in I felt Hunger Games, it crossed the line.
Mm-hmm. And I think, Kate, you bring up such a very important point, which is if you're going to have your children read what we might generally consider controversial, you know, books or things, you've got to be willing to invest your time
yes.
mm-hmm. in actually reading them. And I think there again, most of us live such harried, busy life. We mm-hmm. don't do that. Mm-hmm. And most parents are just kind of willy-nilly saying, oh, there's no big mm-hmm. deal about it, nothing wrong. And then they can't use that as an instruction tool or to be discerning. And I think another point, which you brought up with the Hunger Games, you, with so many of these books, they're series, and same thing even with mm-hmm. television shows. The first one might be great, and you go, mm-hmm. oh, that's wonderful. But as time goes on, they're bringing in other subject matters that you go, I don't want my child exposed
right.
to that. And I think even to a degree, there can be some things that might be different even in a book than a movie. Because sometimes an image gets implanted on your mind, and mm-hmm. once it's there, I mean, I disobeyed my parents and went and saw The Exorcist. I'm really dating myself many years ago. And, you know, one of those sneak out of the house, they're probably watching, and I don't know that they've ever known that I did that. But I will tell you, the natural consequence was that they told me not to. They forbid me from doing it. I knew better, and I went, I can't get those images
yeah.
out of my mm-hmm. mind, you know, 30-plus years, probably a lot more than plus. Than that. And I think we've got to guard our children both in what they read mm-hmm. and especially for girls even can be mm-hmm. where those romance novels
yes,
and
yeah.
things like that can be even more powerful than an image. But we've got to be sensitive, I think. And you've mentioned it before, Kate, it's kind of knowing the age
mm-hmm.
but it's also knowing the bent of the child.
Mm-hmm.
Like
yes,
you'd mentioned,
right.
Gina, before that, you know, one child might be able to, not just age-wise, but
right.
because you might have one child who's a more sensitive child, and the other one is more of a, mm-hmm. come see, come saw.
Now, Nancy, I know that you had shared with us, even before we started taping the show here that Harry Potter for your family was totally off limits. And why did you make that decision?
Well, it was something that we, my husband and I, decided together. We did some research and we prayed about it, and we just saw scripture that pointed to just don't go there with magic and evil and witchcraft. And that's just what we've chosen, mm-hmm. is just to steer clear of it. And it can be, I hear what you said, Kate, in terms of there are other shows. I mean, my children will occasionally, you know, at my mom's or another home that has cable, try to watch a show that has magic. I mean, there was Bewitched when I was younger, and I'm aging myself too. But those types of shows, and we really don't like those either. We kind of just put a stop on those. So it's just one of those things where we felt we just had to draw the line. And just
do you explain that to your children, or is that more something that you and your husband decide together, and then it's just they don't even have access to it?
No, we've definitely discussed it in detail, more so with the older ones in terms of Harry Potter, because they wanted to mm-hmm. see it. They had that desire. The younger ones know not to even ask about it, because we've discussed it so much with the older ones. Mm-hmm. But we discuss it with the younger ones a lot in terms of these other shows that come up that cross that line too. And they do try to do magic and things like that. And I think there is an innocent side of the magic, but I think there is the witchcraft and the satanic piece that I just don't know exactly where that line crosses, and we've just decided to stay clear of it.
And I think that brings up the point that everyone has to be discerning, mm-hmm. and you've got to go to the Lord yourself and say, what are the decisions? Because ultimately, you're not responsible for Kate's kids, and Kate's mm-hmm. not responsible for your kids. But together as a couple, you're responsible for mm-hmm. how you are going to parent your children and to stand before the Lord. And I know, you know, for example, in our family, we didn't do the Harry Potter. We also never celebrated Halloween, and we never mm-hmm. have. So for my children's entire life, they didn't. And that was a lot because of information I heard from some warlocks and some witches about what happens there. So I was so convicted, where I know some other people celebrate that holiday and maybe give up trash.
Wait a minute. Hold the show. Are you talking witches? Like, why don't you explain that? When you say you heard from some warlocks and witches, are you seriously, what do you mean by that?
I mean from some people who were at a church event and had been warlocks and had been a witch.
So they consider themselves witches.
Correct.
Wicca.
Correct. Okay. And were involved in child and animal sacrifices wow. at a point in their life. So once I had heard that, there was no question. And when I understood, and all I would say, I don't want to get off, but Halloween's coming. It's one, you know, next to Christmas now, it's the most multi-million dollar holiday that we have. In fact, some people are saying it's going to surpass. And every time I pass the skeletons or the ghosts or things, I automatically get the creepies. But understanding more of what is behind that celebration, the conviction was so strong that I go, we cannot do that. But that's where you've got to go to the Lord, and I think we've got to make sure we're not ignorant, and again, not to be ignorant of the enemy's schemes. We also don't want to be looking for, you know, something evil behind every corner, mm-hmm. because we do live in the world, and we want to live in the world but not be of the world, and how to balance that.
Well, I'd like to add, too, that we struggled for a while. We did celebrate Halloween when our children were younger. And my husband kept bringing up to me, you know, Nancy, we, you know, are big on not doing the Harry Potter, but we're doing Halloween. You know, you're letting the kids go around to the neighborhood. And I would just, you know, think in my mind, well, we're visiting the neighbors, and my mom lives on our street, and it's innocent. But then the more we just prayed about it, we just kept getting the feeling from the Spirit that we weren't to do it. So a couple years ago, we did stop, and I do feel more comfortable with my decision that I went with what the Holy Spirit had led me through. But sometimes I think it is a process as God reveals
right.
things
mm-hmm.
to you, and you know, you're obedient and kind of make these changes.
Well, and I think like all of what I hear from so many people here today is teaching our kids critical thinking.
Yes.
You know, I can tell you a thing that my husband and I have been in the habit of doing is pointing out what we would call hidden agendas in advertising campaigns, marketing campaigns, commercials. Hey guys, why do you think they make everybody look so happy in that alcohol commercial versus showing mm-hmm. them addicted or puking in the toilet the next day? That's the reality of alcohol, and yet they're going to always continue to show it to you in this light. Why do you think that is? Or this was really insane. We were watching a graph on consumer confidence. We were watching the news, and a graph popped up on consumer confidence. And the graph was, I think it was 81%, and then it had gone up 0.5%. And the 0.5% on the graph, it was like twice the size of the, you know, I'm exaggerating, but it was a much higher number. And my husband said, brought the kids in, we paused the television. I think there's a picture of that there for you to see. But we paused the television, and it was like, okay, guys, is that really what 0.5% growth would look like? Why? What is the benefit of making that 0.5% look that much bigger? And helping our children to realize that there are agendas that are the undercurrent of most of what they're being shown in the world, and we need to help them to identify those now so that they're not caught off guard or buying into these lies that the world is going to continue to put in front of their faces.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's it, Jamie, as you said, critical thinking skills, discernment, how to discern good and evil. And ultimately, the only way you can detect a lie is to know the truth. Yes. And so, you know, what the Lord says, that path is, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The only way you're really going to know is if you know the truth so well that you can discern evil. And the problem, again, in our culture is that most people don't know the word of God, mm-hmm. and therefore they can't know what truly is good and evil. And again, because Satan so often comes disguised as that angel of light, mm-hmm. that it may appear to be great, mm-hmm. just like that graph may appear that that's really
consumer
a big
confidence
difference.
Is way up.
And you begin to look. And I think what you said, Jamie, you know, teaching that, what is the agenda? I mean, don't you think that's important to teach your kids? Mm-hmm. What might be the agenda behind this?
Yes.
You know, because everyone has that.
It's mm-hmm. a great idea. I never really thought of that, Jamie. It's something that you can do as you're watching shows and commercials to point out to your kids.
All the time, billboards. Yeah. I mean, mm-hmm. just right. constantly asking, why do they have that person mm-hmm. dressed that way? Or, you know, we went through the book of Proverbs together as a family, and that's another thing I would recommend, is getting some scriptures and doing like family devotionals where you're pulling out scripture and saying, okay, what is a harlot? I mean, the book of Proverbs especially has so many warnings about seductive women, mm-hmm. and I actually got out a Sports Illustrated magazine, not the swimsuit issue, but it was a magazine that was in our home, and I had the boys flip through and show me what a harlot looks like, because they were in a lot of the ads. And how do you know that? And it's, you know, some people would say, well, that's being judgmental. I'm saying God's already been the judge on that issue. I'm just pointing it out, helping them become aware of that.
They don't have to open a magazine to see.
That's
some of
true.
Those.
I walk through the
mall.
The mall, or I was going to say the grocery line.
Yeah, oh yeah,
absolutely.
I turn all the magazines around
backwards.
Everywhere
on the magazine. Mm-hmm. That's a great suggestion.
I do. I walk and I turn them all.
That's right. Well, and I think when we look again at what Scripture says, and again, we could look and there's so many great wisdom, but 2 Timothy 2:22, flee youthful lusts, pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. We thank you again so much for joining us here at True View.
Honors our newest generation of warriors and veterans. Please join us in supporting and recognizing their unique contributions and needs. Go to legion.org/honorveterans to find out more.
This looks like hide and seek, but it's not. Kids often withdraw when their needs aren't being met. It would be easier if they said, I need a little one-on-one time. But it's up to us, their parents, to learn their language. And once you figure it out, you don't really have to say much at all. A thought from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.